Welcome to Look Up with Pastor Mike and his wife Linda Sasso of Calvary Chapel of Eagle, a radio ministry designed to assist you in applying God's Word to your everyday life. For the next hour, Pastor Mike and Linda will encourage you with your walk with Christ and help you look up to Jesus. If you need advice on marriage, life challenges, or relationships, call in now. It's time to look up to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Here's Mike and Linda.
Well, hi, everybody. This is Pastor Mike. Welcome to Look Up, and it is Friday. I was looking at the topic around thinking, I wonder if we could finish the topic today. We've been looking at seven ways to avoid an affair, and I think we're just breaking into number four. If we move quickly, well, maybe we don't need to move quickly.
No, we don't need to move quickly.
Sometimes I want to really get through one topic and move to the next, but I have been surprised in this series and in many of the other series that I may have five subtopics I want to go over, and we may take a whole hour on each topic. You know, each show, each day, we cover the next topic and the next topic rather than several in one sitting. And I think that just shows you there's lots to talk about. And you know what? Honestly, if I was just reading through it and reading what it said in the articles that I've taken them from, we'd get through them all in one day. But here in studio with my wife and all of our years of experience of helping others in their struggles and marriage problems and on, we've got a lot to say. And so I love taking these articles, maybe ideas from other people, and then running with it and then adding to it. And sometimes we disagree with some of the points and we talk about that. But it gives us a little kickstart, a little spark of what to talk about. So we are, again, looking at seven ways to avoid an affair. I think we've covered the first three. And by the way, it is Friday, June 21st. If you're wondering if this is a replay, and the 21st, that means we're live. If you're listening on June 21st, 2019, that means we're live, and you could call in and you could Facebook us. We want to hear from you because we love interaction with our listeners. I tell you, folks, I've told you this before. If we just wanted to do a radio program, we could produce it in our home and send the audios into the studio. But we come in each day because we love to have some live interaction here. Now, most of the interaction has been either Facebook texts or text to the church phone. Every now and then we get a phone call. But I'll remind you, my favorite interaction is a phone call. I want to hear your voice. I want to interact with you. I want to know if you've got something to share or maybe questions about our topic or opening up a whole new topic. I want to interview you a little bit by way of just finding out what exactly does your question infer, what's behind it, not just give a question and give an answer, because sometimes my answer may not be exactly what you're looking for, okay? So if you can, call in. We'd love to hear from you. Linda's going to tell you how to do that.
Hi, everybody. If you would like to call in, be live on the radio with us, that number is 208-377-3790. Let me give you that one more time. 208-377-3790. If you don't want to be live on the phone, then get up on Facebook, because if you send a text message, it's at my house. I forgot the church phone. It was almost dead, and I was charging it, and I walked out the door without it. So text to the church phone won't work today. We'll get those once we get home. So if you're on Facebook Live, go ahead and leave a comment when it's appropriate. We will address it. Hey, you know, we keep talking about we're married 45 years. Well, that's tomorrow. I didn't even get you a card yet. Life's been crazy, huh? Run around everywhere. And I keep thinking, how could I be married 45 years? I can't be that old. I can't even be 45. You know, times, my mind, my spirit, I don't feel like I'm even that old. But my body sometimes screams that it is. So part of this getting old together. And you know, tomorrow is Calvary Chapel Eagles All Church Picnic and baptism at Esther Simplot Park. Going to be doing the baptizing in Quinn's Pond. I hope there aren't a zillion and one people swimming there. We may have to work around them. We'll see. It's going to be a little cool tomorrow, so it probably won't be as crowded in the water. Starts at noon. The church is providing the drinks and fried chicken, and you're bringing side dishes. And I ran over to Winco and got 6 dozen cookies to bring for tomorrow. Nobody had desserts down, so you got to have desserts, right? Nothing else. You got to have a cookie. So we would love for you to join us, especially if you're part of our Calvary Chapel Eagle family and you didn't know, you didn't sign up. That doesn't make a difference. Show up, okay? Show up. We would love to have you there. And we'll have food, then we'll have the baptism. Then they have all kinds of games and things like that organized. I don't know what they are because I didn't have to do it this year. And I am actually quite elated about that. So I know it's meant to be a fun time, 12 to 4 tomorrow, Esther Simplot Park. Please show up if you're not part of our fellowship, but you want to come join us. Come on. If you need to be baptized, come on down, okay? So there's our commercial. Shall we get into our topic of 7 ways to avoid having an affair?
Well, I think it might be that time. I'm looking at the list here, and actually we only did cover 3. And we could move quickly, but I think that we'll probably have some things to say on each of these. So let's do a quick review. The first 3 that we covered of 7 ways to avoid an affair is, number 1, don't assume it can't happen to you. We went in depth on that. The naivety of thinking that just happens to other people. When you don't think something can happen to you, you won't put your guard up. You won't take precautions, okay? Number 2 is, this is not my title, but I altered it. Their title was Have Sex and a Lot of It. I just think that sounds kind of crass. I think that that is not necessarily the solution. As a matter of fact, I was talking to a friend about when we covered this topic, and I was telling him the things I wanted to say about the sex life within a marriage. I called it make love, not just have sex and a lot of it. I think that when you love your spouse and you make love and what you do is based on love, giving, consideration, kindness, tenderness, thinking of the other person. Lots of times people call sex making love, but it should be making love, and it shouldn't just be a sex act, because animals have sex. People can have sex, but I think married people should make love. Okay. Anyway, a quick review of that.
It is an emotional and spiritual connection,
right?
Besides just a physical connection. That's what we're talking about, right?
Right, right. Okay. Right. Okay. So, number 3 is quit talking to friends from a long time ago. And I think I rewarded it on Facebook of beware of old flings.
Yeah.
Because, you could talk to friends that you haven't seen in a long time, that you're not attracted to, somebody of the same sex who you're just old buddies, every now and then I'll find somebody on Facebook that I remember from high school, or I remember from the early ministry days, and I go, wow, how are you doing? That's good. That's great. That's a good connection. Okay. But the danger is when you reconnect with somebody that you might have had a little bit of a spark going, there is a danger when, you wonder how they're doing now, and remember that one night, all that stuff can be alluring and dangerous. And of course, Linda and I talked about it's more dangerous at various stages of your marriage, because Linda and I have been married 45 years, as she just told you, and we're not at all interested in high school flings from 35 years ago, 40 years ago, whatever. It's not like we're thinking, gee, I wonder what they're doing now, and I miss them. That's just old. That's just old news. Okay, so we did talk about the dangers of social media and what, and secrecy and secret texting and all that kind of stuff as well.
Yeah, I know. The one thing that they're referring to in this is puppy love is very, very naive. And if you look back at it, you remember, those first feelings and those are very, very deceiving because they're not reality. Okay. Remember back puppy love. And that's what they're kind of warning against, is going back to people that you shared a relationship with when the relationship is supposed to be between you and your husband. Mm-hmm. There's where the close relationship should be, the talking and everything. And that leads right into the next one, right?
Yeah.
You okay. ready to go there?
I am.
Okay.
Let's see. Okay. Number four is don't share personal struggles with someone you're not married to. And again, you know, we just someone, you know what we're talking about. Someone who's a potential empathizer and sympathizer who go, oh, you poor man. If I was your wife, I would never treat you like that. You know, there are certain situations that are more dangerous than others. Let's say, for instance, don't share personal struggles with someone you're not married to. All right. My brother has been in ministry for many, many years. He has been my accountability partner and prayer partner for many years. My brother George has been on staff at Calvary Chapel, Chino Hills. He's been on several church staffs. Right now, he's the marriage and family pastor there. We call each other frequently and talk and pray. There's times we'll just say, let's give a day of fasting towards something, and we pray together. That's not what we're talking about, okay? It's good to have safe accountability partners. It's good to have maybe within your men's group, or if you're a woman, within your women's group, a person, not the whole group. I think it's wrong to just air your dirty laundry with a whole bunch of people, because for one thing, it can spawn some gossip. And it also, you never know what's going to happen with that. It's good to find somebody you could trust and share the personal struggles for the purpose of prayer and godly counsel. Okay, I'll read this article and we'll comment on it, but you know.
Yeah, I was going to say, when we read this article, what they are actually trying to warn against here with this one is maybe you don't go out and have a physical affair, but there are such things as an emotional affair. You know what I'm talking about, okay? You get to where you're getting into that intimate place emotionally that should only be for your spouse. So that's what this one is addressing. I think the first title of it kind of throws it off a little bit.
Well, I'm real tempted to give some stipulations and guidelines and exceptions, you know?
Oh, and we can, but let's read what they were.
Okay.
No, you go ahead. I'm not good at reading these.
Okay. And again, this is an article from Thriving Marriage Ministry, and we have taken a lot of material from them. You could go on the web and find Thriving Marriages and subscribe to their articles. I think almost every day, if not every day, and I know weekly, I get scores of, sometimes I'll get an email with several helpful articles, and I could think, you know what, I'm going to save this one for the radio talk. And so, you know, if you're looking, if you're in marriage ministry, or if you're looking for ministry for your marriage, you might search online for Thriving Marriages. Thriving Marriages. And that ministry has been really helpful. They come up with a lot of good stuff. But again, like any ministry, there are some things that I don't always agree with everything, but it's worth taking a look at. Okay, so let's read it now. The title of number four is don't share personal struggles with someone you're not married to, and here's their explanation for that. One of the most devastating challenges a couple can face in their relationship is an emotional affair. It can occur very quickly when boundaries are crossed, usually by talking too much. Unfortunately, many couples don't realize how important it is to have boundaries. Try to avoid conversations with the opposite sex friends and co-workers regarding problems in your marriage or their marriages. It will spare you from the heartache which comes from receiving or providing emotional support outside your marriage. The exchange of such information is meant to stay between husband and wife. Now, I think I need to make some clarifications here. I've got some comments, but there's a phrase here a lot of people may not be familiar with. It's called an emotional affair, okay? An emotional affair, I would describe it as you are emotionally attached to someone. I would say it goes beyond a crush. There's times you may notice somebody of the opposite sex who you're not married to that you think, man, they're good looking. That's not a sin. Don't act on it. But it's not a sin to notice when somebody's good looking. There's times when you could just even think, I like that person and they're good looking. That's not right. I think with the emotional affair, what we're talking about is when you cross over to where you just can't wait till next time you see them. I think an emotional affair, how can you tell? Now I'm just pulling this out of the air because I didn't write any of this down. But when you're, maybe it's somebody at work or somebody at church, and you're thinking, oh, I can't wait till the next time I go to church because maybe so-and-so will be there and I'll get to see them again. Something wrong is happening there, okay? Because your heart is being pulled towards that person. An emotional affair can go a step further than that, of course, to where you're working with somebody or it's somebody in a ministry that you're in, someone you see on a fairly regular basis, and you've shared information with them that is very intimate and private information. That's what this article is referring to. And you know what? When you share intimate information with somebody, there is something special about that where you now hold a bond together that others don't know this about you, but they do. And now you've trusted them with your heart, so to speak. And an emotional affair could mean you begin to give compliments, you begin to give encouragement, and it could all look good on the outside. Somebody on the outside could say, well, that's just a good friend trying to uplift you up, and no, you're really a good-looking person. I think your wife should be happy to be married to someone as charming as you. You know, there's all kinds of flattery that can take place. I've known pastors who have gotten into emotional affairs but never crossed the line into an actual physical affair. Nothing turned sexually active, but their hearts were given over to these women, and it can happen very easy if you don't keep your guard up. If you don't put, there's another term that was in this article, boundaries. It says, unfortunately, many couples don't realize how important it is to have boundaries. And the boundaries are not just, you can only come this close to me, here's the boundary, I can't touch you. That might be a boundary. There are some people, you know, there's been some really good-looking gals that I've known in different churches I've been to that I won't hug them. I just think it's just, that's a boundary I need to put up, okay? Because I'm a real huggy-touchy guy, if you know me. I'm the kind of guy that I can't keep my hands off you. I just want to give you a hug. Sometimes the guys, I'll just hit them in the shoulder or give them a hug or rough up a little bit. I'm Italian. I don't know if that's part of my culture or what, but I'm that way. But there's people who I remember in times past, I'm not going to hug that person just because there's the potential of sparks or an emotional attachment. And you keep your boundaries up. You keep the barriers up. And so an emotional affair, you might even excuse it and think that you're safe. There's nothing wrong with this. I haven't touched her. Or I haven't touched him. I haven't made a pass at them, but in your heart, you're getting dependent upon the next time I'm going to see that person, and that's when you got to catch that, because other people won't catch it. You'll catch it first. By the way, other people might see it. Yeah. There's times people could see how you light up when that person comes around, you know, how you seem to, all of a sudden you're always smiling and laughing and giggling and or making clever little remarks when that person comes into the room. Other people might even see that, okay? So we're talking about the danger of an emotional affair, the importance of putting up boundaries, and it's under the title of don't share personal struggles with someone you're not married to. So obviously there are some people it's safe to share with and pray with, and you should. I think every man should have at least one other man in his life that he can talk to about anything. And he could trust that information into that man like a brother in the Lord, like I've got my brother, George, okay? And there's been very few people in my life that I can do that with. There's been, over the years, there's been some. Unfortunately, they've come and gone. My brother, he stays my brother. Okay. So anyway, let me recommend that to you. Instead of that number four, not sharing any personal struggles with somebody you're not married to, if you're a guy, find a brother in the Lord that you could trust. That you know, be careful. Shop slowly, okay? Don't just go up to somebody that maybe he's a leader in the church and go, will you be my accountability partner? Don't start off like that. The Lord will show you. The Lord will show you who it is that you can connect with. Maybe it's somebody in your small group. Maybe it's somebody in the prayer meeting that you go to. But make sure it's not somebody of the opposite sex that you might be attracted to. Make sure it's somebody that you could trust with any information, and that somebody that you will, they will pray with you and encourage you in a godly way, okay? And gals, same thing for you. Find a woman you could trust. Now, it hasn't always been the case for me and Linda. There's been times we don't have anybody. There's been times we go through a period of time when she doesn't have that certain woman that she could trust, and so I'm the guy. We talk about everything together. We don't keep secrets from one another. Fortunately, after all these years, we are each other's best friend, okay? But I can see she's got something to add, so I'm going to turn it over to her right now.
Well, I was going to say, you know, this is one of those traps that pastors or counselors can get stuck in. And that's why you'll see more and more churches that the men are not counseling the women, because the women come in, want to talk about their marriage problems. This is a pastor. I should be able to tell him anything and talk about it. But when a pastor shows a pastor's heart of kindness, of compassion, then all of a sudden that woman can have an emotional affair like that. They can get emotionally attached, and then they become dependent on the pastor. And then it can get to the point where some of them decide they're going to pursue the pastor. That's why it's always so dangerous with talking about these things. So many times, if there's marriage counseling, we want to counsel both people together. You're going to get weird stories if you only hear one person's side of it. And usually we'll do marriage counseling as a couple with a couple, because we'll see things that the other person may not see, and we may be able to help them in that. But it's really dangerous. It's that simple of just that compassionate heart that they aren't getting at home can cause somebody to become infatuated with you. And some people will never act upon that. But some people will. They're so lonely that they will act upon that infatuation, not caring if you're married or any of those other things, and deliberately attempt to cause you to get into a relationship with them. This is what we're trying to avoid. Let's cut it off at the pass, okay? And that's why when Mike was talking to people before counseling, and if a woman wanted to talk about anything sexual, it's like, okay, stop right there. And you pass her off to a woman. Same thing if a man tries talking to a woman about sexual problems he's having with his wife. We don't talk about those things. I'm sorry. There is a man over there you need to go talk to about those kind of things, okay? In the larger church, when Mike was an assistant pastor, he didn't have so much control. Somebody booked an appointment, you meet with them. And the wisdom is pastors left their doors open. They put windows in the doors so that it's not just a shut office and there's two people in there. You know what? It's taken time from the early days to now. The wisdom of not counseling opposite sex people, and especially recognizing the signs. Now, me, I could tell him every woman that was becoming infatuated. I could see it. I'm a woman, you know. And there are many times when in the bigger churches, the pastors used to stand up at the stairs and pray for whoever wanted to come up. And you just start noticing the same women going to the same man, same pastor every time. You start watching it there, and then you start seeing that they've got to reach out. They've got to try to touch. You know, there's all these signs you can watch for and see. And at that point, when I seen that, I'd usually come right up alongside of him, put my arm in his, and just say hi to the person with a big smile, you know, and kind of stake him a claim. And that helped so many times. Because when I would look into a woman's eyes, she knew I had her number. She knew I knew what she was doing, and usually back off at that point. So this is what an emotional affair is you become dependent and enjoy talking to, you feel like you have the same heart as this person. And I'll tell you, I would presume very, very few affairs ever turn into a physical affair without it being an emotional affair first.
Right, of course.
Now, some guy just sleeping around and picking up anybody, we're not talking about that. We're talking about somebody having an affair. This is, I look at affair as something you really might not have been planning on, and you kind of
well, let's
found
just
yourself
say that's
that
a difference between Christians and non-Christians.
Cause well,
a Christian would not necessarily fall into something like that without slowly being seduced into it.
Yeah. Or we hope Christians wouldn't fall into that. Mm. And one more time, we're going to say, you know what? We prayed on the way here. Lord, put somebody listening to this program today that is actually considering having an affair. We want to talk to you. We want to stop you before it's too late. And if you are in an emotional affair, you need to stop right there, recognize what it is, repent of it, and back away from that person. If it's your pastor, you may need to change churches. You may actually need to change churches if you've allowed yourself to become that emotionally attached. But you need to confess it before the Lord. Ask the Lord to take it away. And, you know, it doesn't have to be even a married person. A lot of single women will get emotionally attached to usually the married men in a church or at work. And it's so dangerous. It's a slippery slope, and you don't know where the point is that you slip down further into doing what you never dreamed you would do. Or you're just one that's become dependent on a man or a woman in your life, and all of a sudden you decide to take it the next step. You would have never done that. You would have never done that. But you became emotionally dependent on this person. We told you about the person who basically stalked us on Facebook, would rip our pictures off, would print them up, put them in frames around the house and everything. That should not be. That should not be. Because then it can turn into a fantasy world where then in your dreams, you're, oh gosh, you know what? It's dangerous. It's not what the Lord wants. So if you keep your personal struggles to yourself or to one very close friend of the same sex, make sure it's somebody you can trust. And you know what? With most of it, with this, I even feel, see, I don't have people I would talk to about things like that if it wasn't you, basically. Any struggles I have within my life at all, I talk to you. But I think the one place we need to go above anything, even above our spouse, is to the Lord. When we got struggles, we need to take them to the Lord. Mm-hmm. Because you know what? It's so easy when you're not happy in your marriage to sit there and look at the other person and say, well, they did this, they did that, they did this, they, and we want to point the finger at the other person. But when we take our problems to the Lord and we say, Lord, show me what my part is. He's faithful to do that. He will show you what you're doing wrong. And then you stop and go, oh, wait, I got upset that he said this. Oh, but I said that that caused this. And you know what I'm talking about, don't you? Take it to the Lord first. Then you may not need to talk to anybody because the Lord may just fix you. Well, that's our music for our 1 minute break that we're going to take at the top of the hour. So we will be back in 60 seconds.
Jesus does. You're listening to 94.1 The Voice, KBXL, Caldwell, Boise. radio you can believe in. Stay tuned, we'll be right back. Look Up airs every Monday through Friday afternoon from 2:30 to 3:30. Through Facebook Live, text, and phone, you can ask questions on what the Bible has to say about the real things that are going on in your life. If you'd like to text the Sassos, the number is 208-891-2635. The best way to have your question answered is to call the Sassos in the studio right now. That number is 208-377-3790. To learn more about Calvary Chapel Eagle, visit calvarychapeleagle.com. Now, here's Mike and Linda.
All right, here's Mike and Linda. Listen, we did want to make a couple more comments on don't share personal struggles with someone you're not married to. We're under the topic of 7 ways to avoid an affair, and it's from Thriving Marriage Ministries. I think one principle when it's talking about don't talk to people about your problems outside of your marriage, it really comes down to keeping your relationship special and exclusive, that you protect your relationship. And boundaries is one way to do that, that there are certain things I don't talk to anybody else but my wife about. Matter of fact, Linda and I are always talking about how to expand that category. You know, there are always things we realize, you know what, we may talk about those things at home between the two of us, but let's not talk that way or about those things to anybody else. And they may not be sinful things, but there's some things we just feel like when we're with others, especially since we are ministry people and we're a ministry couple, we want to talk ministry with people. We want to be encouraging. We want to, like Philippians 4:8, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are true, if there be any good report, if there be worthy of praise, dwell on these things. We want to be uplifting and encouraging to others. And so even when we're talking about problems in the church or problems that we have with certain people or whatever, that should just be between Linda and I, because we don't want to taint anyone else's reputation. We don't want to even taint somebody else's attitude towards other people. And so that's another thing to keep in mind. But this is all under the category of the exclusivity of your marriage, that there are things you could deal with at home and you could deal with between the two of you that you don't deal with anywhere else. There's certain topics you talk about. There's certain problems you deal with that you shouldn't bring outside of the home. And so boundaries. We've talked about that enough. But one more thing under that category, I want to remind you that God places a really high regard and value upon your vows, the vows that you made with your spouse. I think covenants are very, very important before the Lord. A covenant that I have made a promise. You know, God keeps his promises. God is faithful. And I think one of the things that makes adultery so ugly, one of the things, is that it's a violation of faithfulness. It's a violation of your loyalty. And you've made a covenant. You've made marriage vows. You've made a promise. God is a covenant keeper. God is a promise keeper. And he wants us to be faithful as well. We want to be like our Heavenly Father. And so we want to follow his example and be faithful and be loyal. As a matter of fact, one of the texts I want to take a moment to read you is from Malachi chapter 2. And I think one of the Bibles I looked at, it says, it was titled, The Treachery of Infidelity. And really, it's a chunk of scripture, so bear with me. I'm going to start from Malachi chapter 2, verse 10, just to get some context in here. But, you know, this is the text, and you've all heard the story, or you've heard at least the bumper sticker saying, God hates divorce. Well, there's a story behind that, okay? It's not just that God hates divorce. As a matter of fact, God doesn't hate divorced people, okay? He doesn't hate people who went through a divorce. As a matter of fact, there's times, I'd say more than likely, his heart is broken for you. So the thing is, we want to keep in mind, so why does God hate divorce, okay? This is the text where we get the saying, God hates divorce. But let me read it to you. It's about loyalty. It's about faithfulness. As a matter of fact, I've looked at a couple different translations in the last few minutes. I decided once more to go to the New Living Translation, and it's subtitled A Call to Faithfulness. And verse 10 of Malachi 2, New Living Translation, says, "Are we not all children of the same Father? Are we not all created by the same God? Then why do we betray each other, violating the covenant of our ancestors?" Okay, now, he starts out talking about just cheating and you know, you make a deal and you back out on a deal. He's talking about general betrayal. He's going to zero in on marriage in a moment here, but let's just flow with this. Judah has been unfaithful, and a detestable thing has been done in Israel and Jerusalem. Men of Judah have defiled the Lord's beloved sanctuary by marrying women who worship idols. Now, of course, we know this is the story of Solomon. King Solomon, the wisest man who ever lived, he went south in the latter part of his life because he added these foreign women who worshiped idols into his life. He married. Now, okay, to be fair, let me explain. There's an excuse for it. I mean, let's say there's a reason for it. There's not an excuse. The reason is what kings did in those days, and even some kings, I don't know how many do them today in third world countries, but if you're a king and you're making a treaty with a bordering country or even a land that's afar off that you want to make sure we will never go at war together, quite often part of the treaty would be the king of that foreign land who wants to make a treaty with the bigger, more powerful king will give one of his daughters in marriage to the powerful king, saying, "Look, take my daughter and you will be married. Now we'll have a covenant, we'll have a treaty, and we'll never go to war with each other." And because Solomon was the king who reigned over Israel when they were at their largest, when their borders were expanded further than it's ever been, many kings made treaties with Solomon and gave Solomon their daughters as wives. And so Solomon had over 300 wives and many, many concubines, and it just was ridiculous. And so there's the reason. Okay, and why do I take the time to tell this? Is because everything that goes wrong in a believer's life, in a Christian's life, you might have a good reason for it, but you never have an excuse for it. Okay? Solomon could say, "Well, you know, this is the business I'm in, and I'm a politician, and that's the way kings run things." Well, guess what? It was his demise. It brought him to the place to where he was allowing these foreign women to erect, the idols and sanctuaries to these foreign gods, and it was destructive. And so, you know what? I know this is a mini sermon within a sermon, but let me say it anyway. One of the things that I've stressed in our congregation, when we've gone through the Book of Proverbs in our midweek service, I've often told people, because they would say, "Why in the world, if he's the wisest man who ever lived and God gave him more wisdom than anybody who ever lived, how could he do the things he did?" And my answer to them and my answer to you is, wisdom alone is not enough to stop you from turning from the Lord. It doesn't matter how wise you are. You need to act upon the wisdom that God's given you. And as a matter of fact, the downfall, the demise was that Solomon allowed himself to be influenced by bad influences. He allowed himself to be exposed to those who would eventually seduce and lure him into the wrong direction. And my go-to scripture for that is 2 Corinthians 5:33 that says, "Don't be deceived, my brethren. Bad company corrupts good morals." Don't be deceived. Even Solomon, as wise as he was, once he began to surround himself with bad company, it corrupted his good morals. So I don't care how smart you are. I don't care how godly you think you are and what kind of good stock you come from, a good denomination, a good family, whatever. I don't care what all those reasons, you add them all up. If you allow yourself to be surrounded by bad company, it will take its toll on you. I would say particularly friends, especially the ones you marry, like Solomon, okay? But there's times you can't pick who you work with, okay? The workplace, when you go to school, when you go to work, there's certain things you have no control over. But you can decide who you're going to get intimate with, who you're going to be friendly with, who you're going to share your life, share your heart with. And when Solomon began to share his heart, to open his heart to these foreign women, it brought destruction in his life. It brought spiritual demise to him. 1 Corinthians 15:33, Be not deceived, my brethren. Bad company corrupts good morals. I'm quoting that one from the New American Standard. There's lots of different ways to look at it. You look it up yourself in your favorite translation. Let me keep reading here. Malachi chapter 2, verse 12 says, may the Lord cut off from the nation of Israel every last man who has done this and yet brings an offering to the Lord of heaven's armies. Or some of your Bibles would say the Lord of hosts. Now, what he's saying here is, you know what? God's going to bring destruction, or may God bring destruction, on the people who live one way and talk another. Okay? It says, may the Lord cut off from the nation of Israel every last man who has done this and yet brings an offering to the Lord. Okay? Here's the problem. Many of you, you go to church, you sing the songs, you put money in the box or the basket when it passes, however it goes. You do your religious service, but you're being unfaithful to the Lord in other ways. Or you're being unfaithful to the Lord in your marriage, okay? So Malachi is condemning those who act religious and you know, they'll make sacrifices unto the Lord. They'll bring offerings unto the Lord. They do religious things and offer religious acts. But in reality, their life's not right. Okay, let me keep reading here. Here's another thing you do. You cover the Lord's altar with tears, weeping and groaning because he pays no attention to your offering and doesn't accept them with pleasure. You cry out, why doesn't the Lord accept my worship? I'll tell you why. Because the Lord witnessed the vows. The Lord witnessed the vows you and your wife made when you were young, but you've been unfaithful to her. Though she remained your faithful partner, the wife of your marriage vows. Wow. I know there are people right now within the sound of my voice hearing this program, you're tempted to turn the radio off. But the Lord's convicting you, and you're wondering, why aren't things the way they used to be in my life? I used to be so close to God. I remember I used to just feel his presence during worship, and I used to be used by God mightily, and I'd even lead people in the sinner's prayer, and you could go back and think about the good old days, and you wonder, where's God? How come he's abandoned me? He hasn't abandoned you, but you've abandoned him, my friend. And it says, why doesn't the Lord accept my worship? And Malachi says, I'll tell you why. Because the Lord has witnessed the vows you and your wife made when you were young, but you've been unfaithful to her. Ouch. Let me tell you, I promise you, this is applicable today. Though this book of Malachi was written many, many years ago in the Old Testament times, so to speak, I'm telling you, if you are not living faithful to your wife or to your husband, don't expect the Lord to bless your life. Don't expect the Lord to, I still belong to church and I do all these good things and I give money. And God is holding his nose at the stench of your life. Let me continue to read. Didn't the Lord, verse 15, Malachi 2, didn't the Lord make you one with your wife? In body and in spirit, you are his. What does he want? Godly children from your union. So guard your heart, remain loyal to the wife of your youth. Now, can I tell you, if some of you who are listening to this study right now, you've already crossed the line, you think it's too late, repent. It's not too late. It's too late to be pure and holy and everything's fine, but you know what? You could stop right now. You could ask the Lord for cleansing, ask the Lord for forgiveness, and repent. Break off that relationship. Allow the Lord to fix what you have broken, okay? So then the Lord make you one with your wife, in body and in spirit you are his. But what does he want? Godly children from your union. By the way, we've talked about this before too, that the your children are watching you. Your children are affected by what you do. The children of divorced parents are highly likely to get divorced themselves because unfaithfulness has been modeled for them. We need to model loyalty and faithfulness, and could I use the word stick-to-itiveness? I think it's important to have perseverance, that even when things look bad, even when your children can tell things are not right, you remain to be a faithful man or woman of God. And I think that's modeling something to the kids, that when things aren't all going well. You know, I've heard people say, well, it's really bad for the kids for us to stay together because the kids see us, the tension in our relationship, and the kids, they hear our arguments, and they've heard things. You know what? Well, stop using any foul language or unacceptable language. That's your fault. You think it's going to fix everything for the kids? If you divorce your spouse and go marry somebody else, Malachi 2:15 says, what does he want? He wants godly children from your union. And so what you need to do is realize you are modeling something for the kids, folks. You say, well, it's not right to stick together just for the kids. No, but that is one reason. There's many other reasons. There's stick together for the Lord's sake, for the reputation of Christianity, and for your own sake, because you will be better for it. We've already talked about this in several of these points. Linda and I have told you our story, how we've had rough years, and yet the Lord has brought goodness out of the rough things that we've gone through. I just read an article today on the web. One of the pastors, the Calvary Chapel pastors, is talking about how we get pearls, and we get pearls from an oyster that has had something irritating him. He had something really irritable in his life, and he covered it with the best part of him. Isn't that something? That's kind of cool. I'm going to read that article a little bit more careful and see if I want to use some of that stuff. Good stuff. Okay, so what does the Lord want? He wants godly children from your union, so guard your heart and remain loyal to the wife of your youth. What does that have to do with godly children? You are setting the limits. You're setting the standard. That the way you live, you're showing kids, when things get rough, don't throw in the towel. Kids, they see mom and I aren't getting along, but you know what? We're gonna make this work. We're gonna stick through it. And it's not just for the kids, but it certainly is for the kids as well. Okay, well, let's keep reading. Here's that verse that so many people quote. This is Malachi 2:16, and God says, "I hate divorce," says the Lord, the God of Israel. To divorce your wife is to overwhelm her with cruelty. Says the Lord of Heaven's armies. So guard your hearts and do not be unfaithful to your wife. Now, of course, you think, what about the man? Why are you saying you're cruel to your wife? Well, of course, in this culture, the women didn't work, and they were totally dependent upon the man. And if a man just kicked her to the curb and divorced his wife, he's being cruel, giving cruelty upon cruelty to her. I think there's cruelty in both directions. If you divorce your husband or if you divorce your wife, you're being cruel. You're saying you're not worth working on. You're not worth sticking in there for. Now, I've told you before, there's been very few exceptions where I thought somebody should divorce their husband or wife. Very few times where I've actually felt that. But there are times when for your safety or the safety of your children or because of abuse, there's a few, or because of unfaithfulness. You're married to somebody who's already proven themselves unfaithful, and they are not faithful to you, and they're sleeping around. Well, you know what? They've already nullified the marriage. They've already destroyed the marriage bond. You're not doing any destruction by divorcing a spouse that is in continual adultery against you. What you're doing is protecting yourself and the kids. Okay, so little side note there. So he says, guard your heart and do not be unfaithful to your wife. Now, there's one more verse I want to read in here. It's the last verse of the chapter. It's Malachi 2:17. You have wearied the Lord with your words. How have we wearied him, you ask? You have wearied him by saying that all who do evil are good in the Lord's sight, and he is pleased with them. You have wearied him by asking, where is the God of justice? Okay, now I might pull it back up to the new King James where I was reading it earlier, but I think the point is what God is saying is we get to the point when our society gets so messed up and what's right is wrong, what's wrong is right, and then we say that, let me read it in the new King James, everyone who does evil is good in the sight of the Lord, okay? And I think that really that really is a description of American Christianity. That it's not wrong to do this, and it's not wrong to do that. And there's nothing. As a matter of fact, I saw a poll I just recently posted up on my Facebook of what is considered morally acceptable and what is considered morally unacceptable, and how things have changed over the years. And one of the things that has totally flipped over the years, what is morally acceptable today is divorce. Okay. And it's talking about polling Christians and you know, Christians in America, that it used to be very unacceptable if you were a divorced person. People would look down on you. And I'm not saying it should be like that either. Okay. I'm saying that we should always keep what sin is sin, that God calls it sin. Okay. But here it is. You are saying, God says through Malachi to God's people, you say everyone who does evil is good in the sight of the Lord. And that's where we start really going in the wrong direction. We excuse people's behavior. We excuse an unbiblical divorce. We excuse actions that, well, everybody is doing it, and everybody does that, whether it's divorce, whether it's pornography, whether it's sex before marriage. You could go on and on with this list. There are things that now the culture accepts, and so the church begins to accept it. And when the church begins to accept it, then they'll say this saying, everyone who does evil is good in the sight of the Lord. Will they say it like that? No. No. They'll say, that's not really evil. That's not really wrong. Oh, okay, well, everybody's a sinner, and everybody does some kind of sin. But that, you know what? That's that. We live in the 20th century, or the 21st century. You know, that's not how we think now. And it also says, here's the other thing. You say, in what way have we wearied the Lord? In that you say, everyone who does evil is good in the sight of the Lord, and he delights in them. Ooh, wait a minute. Not only is it okay to do what is abominable, abomination before the Lord, we excuse it and we say it's okay, but then we come to the next step and we say, God delights in you. You know, that's America's pastor. That's the way Christianity is today, with the most famous TV pastors out there are saying, do you know that God delights in you, and he is for you, not against you, and you are good and not evil? You know what? There are times some people need to hear, no, God is not for you. He is not for what you're doing. He is against your sin, okay? So beware of American Christianity when it crosses that line and says that it tries to imply that everyone who does evil is good in the sight of the Lord, and God delights in him, okay, or delights in them. God does not delight in sin. He never delights in sin. And when we're talking about divorce right now, okay, God says in Malachi 2:16 that he hates divorce. We already told you why. It's because, it's not because, well, you're a sinner, divorce. It's because divorce is a sign of unfaithfulness and abandoning your covenant before the Lord and breaking your vows. Divorce is the opposite of what God is and what God promises you. He is faithful to you. He wants you to be faithful to one another. God will not abandon you. Even when you've been unfaithful to him, He doesn't kick you to the curb. He doesn't abandon you. He's a faithful God. He wants to bring you to repentance. He wants you to bring you to the place where you confess your sins and get right with him. He wants to win you to him. He has plans for good, not evil. Absolutely. But here's the thing. It comes through repentance. Okay? So Malachi 2, after 16, that says God hates divorce, he's explaining, why is God tired of us? Why is God weary with his people? Because you're saying stuff like, or implying, that everyone who does evil is good in the sight of the Lord, and he delights in them. Okay? And then, of course, there's one more saying here in verse 17. Or another thing that you say is, where is the God of justice? You know what? That cracks me up. When people see an atrocity done, they see something wrong, and they say, why does God allow that? Where is the God of justice? Why doesn't God judge that person? Why doesn't God just destroy that? Why does God allow that person to do that? Let me tell you something, my friend. Be careful when you say that, because if you really believe that, there's probably been times in your life that God should have wiped you out for the things you've said, or the things that you've done. If you want God to be a God of justice, and you really believe that, we'd all be in trouble, okay? We'd all, you know, I think it's Ecclesiastes 7:20 that says, oh Lord, if you were to judge sin, who could stand, all right? The fact is, we all need God's mercy. We all need his forgiveness. And so don't ever come off of like, where's the God of justice? He's not just. Well, if he was totally just, each one of us would have some payments to make. We'd all be in trouble. Okay. So anyway, I think we're just about finished with that. Verse 17, we've only got a couple minutes left. And so, you know what? We didn't get a caller today. And I think we had a few texts and comments. So before I go into this next one, Hunter, are there any of the article, any comments that anybody made we need to run with, or should I just? I know somebody said that the broadcast is choppy. I hope that it's not everybody is receiving a choppy broadcast. I need to work on some of that. There's some ideas I have for that. So anyway, listen, I could read this. Do you get something, hon?
Well, I was going to say that we have to take serious when God says he hates something. We need to hate it too. Okay. Mm. We don't hate the divorced people. Mm-hmm. Okay. But divorce, if there is a way to avoid it, God's people should. If there is a way to fix this, it may not be your first choice. You may have been pushed to your limit. You may have said, I had enough. Or you may just be living in the flesh and say, oh, I just don't love them anymore. Those are not good excuses. Irreconcilable differences. That can mean anything. That is just an excuse that I want to do what I want to do. God says he hates divorce, so we got to take it serious. We have to listen when God says, you know, this is what you're supposed to do. Because people are saying, where's God? Why isn't he hearing me? Well, tell you why. You dealt treacherously.
That's easy for you to say. Yeah.
Not always the wife of your youth, you know, or vice versa. Woman, you can be the cause of the problem too, okay? You can have the wandering, unfaithful heart. And it could be your husband sitting at home just wishing you would be there for him. Be there for him. Mm. You know, the one thing Mike recommended, The Myth of the Greener Grass. You know what? You can read it. I haven't found that yet to post it up there. I will. Hey, you know what? It's Friday. So, go to church. Go to church. Join us at the picnic tomorrow, Esther Simplot Park at 12 noon. Bless you guys.
If you'd like to know more about Calvary Chapel of Eagle, just go to the website at cceagle.org. Be sure and join Pastor Mike every Saturday at 8 p.m. and on Sundays at 8 a.m. for his radio show, It's All About Jesus. If we ran out of time and you didn't get a chance to call in, you can send your questions to lookup at cceagle.org. And may the Lord richly bless you as you continue to look up to Jesus. Look forward.